Behind the Leaf discusses cannabis in terms of education, history, culture, policy, and advocacy. It is geared for adults only. If you are not an adult, come back when you are.
From the LBCA, Director of Community Education, and we're here with Behind the Leaf.
I'm Steven, Community Outreach Director, and I'm tuning in from space.
And I'm tuning in from up in the trees.
On this episode of Behind the Leaf, you're going to actually learn who Mezzrow is with me on High History, and we also sit down with LBCA team member Robert Cota and talk about his journey to being a cannabis activist.
And we'll also take a tour with Vaporwave, as well as sitting down with our Zoom media group at the root of it.
Join us on this episode of Behind the Leaf.
All right, let's go.
Boom.
Man, what's the matter with that cat there?
Must be full of reefers.
Full of reefers?
Yeah, man.
You mean that cat's high?
Sailing. Lightly.
Get away from here. Man, is that the reefer, man?
That's the reefer, man.
I believe he's lost his mind.
I think he lost his mind.
Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of High History. I'm your host tonight, Steven. Happy 420. I hope everyone enjoyed their time. I know quarantine life, we do what we can, but thank you for tuning in. And today I am going to take you back to the 1930-1940 Reefer Jazz era. Specifically, I want to know, if I was in Harlem, New York in the 1930s, where would I find cannabis? Today on High History, we're going to learn about Milton Mezzrow. Milton Mezzrow was born in Chicago, Illinois on November 9th, 1899, to a Jewish family. Growing up in Chicago, Milton genuinely enjoyed the street life. In and out of trouble, actually stole a Studebaker and got sent to Pontiac Reformatory School. His parents thought Pontiac was going to be the best place for him, and ultimately, it was probably the biggest blessing in his life. Pontiac Reformatory School was actually referred to as that school on account of the kids who actually went there. It wasn't a good place to be, but Milton found it to be his safe haven. Pontiac is where Mezz discovered jazz music, African-American culture, and African-American people. He said at Pontiac, that's where he learned how to play the saxophone. In his book, Really the Blues, he stated that in Pontiac, he learned something important, quote, that there aren't many people in this world with as much sensitivity and plain human respect as the Negroes. I'd be stepping along in line feeling lone and lonesome, and all of a sudden, one of the boys in the colored line, Yellow or King or maybe somebody I didn't even know, would call out, "Hey boy, what you know?" and smile. And I'd feel good all over. He said, I never found many white men with that kind of right instinct and plain friendly feeling that hits you at that psychological moment like a tonic. He felt that the message that you can get from a couple of ordinary words and a smile, he said that's what saved him a few times from going to the dark side of the jailhouse. Mezz genuinely appreciated African-American culture, and he said that they not only taught him their fine music, he felt welcomed. Now, Mezz was just your average musician, but as soon as he discovered marijuana, he became an instant fan. He said that it helped him play better, that he could feel the vibrations of the music. Moving to New York in 1929, Mezz quickly became one of the most popular men in Harlem. He had so much influence that he became known as the white boy with all of the Mexican weed. He was known as the single source of Mexican mota. He was the reefer man. He was the plug. In his book, he states, "As soon as we got some of that Mexican bush, we almost blew our tops. Papa, you never smacked your chops on anything sweeter in all of your days of viping. It had such a wonderful smell, and the kick you got really got out of this world. Guys used to say it was a chocolate candy, a brand Hershey's never even thought of." That sounds like some crazy weed. All I'm saying is I've always wondered, like, what Mezz would have smoked, and, like, reading that was, like, chocolate weed. That's the answer. Mezz quickly became known for the best cannabis around. He said that jazz musicians would come by to his studio just to smoke with him. In his book, he never states exactly which jazz musicians he smoked with, but he said, "They used to drop by to sit in and get high with me, because I always had the best stuff that could be found. We would have a jam up session playing until we fractured all of our toupees." He even said a couple of times he had to go pick up from his connect a little Mexican guy named Pascual. Mezz said that if you picked up from Pascual back in the day, you know Prince Albert, the big red tobacco cans? He said that you can get cannabis packed in there with no sticks, no seeds, no stems for only $2. A big can of Prince Albert tobaccos full of cannabis back in the day. Where's Pascual now? Just kidding, bilegal. Mezz became so well known for his reefer that other musicians actually started referring to him in their music. Have you ever heard the verse, "The Mighty Mezz But Not Too Strong"? It's actually in the song "You're a Viper" by Stuff Smith. Have you heard it? I personally like it. So you know what? This is high history. I'm gonna roll up this joint. I'm gonna play you about 30 seconds, and you know, we'll get right back to it.
Come on down, gate. Let's smoke a little tea this evening, huh? Three-pound reaper, 5 feet long, the mighty mess, but not too strong. You get high, but not for long.
Why, man?
Cause you's the viper. Yeah. Now I'm the king of everything. You gotta get high to have that swing. Light as tea, let it be. Cause you's the viper. Now your throat gets dry and you know you're high. Everything is dandy. Truck into the candy store. Bust your conk on peppermint candy. Then you know your body's spent. You don't give a darn if you don't pay rent. Sky's high, you high.
Why?
Cause you's the viper.
I hope you guys enjoyed that song. I'm not even gonna lie, this is my first joint of the day, so it's nighttime, but I'm honest, this is my first joint. So I'm happy and I'm excited. But since we're, you know, this is high history, you know what, I think this is pretty cool, because this, you know, this is a little high history for the LBCA. But this lighter right here, this little green one, is actually, don't lose your key. Little key. This lighter is actually from the California Buyers Club. The California Buyers Club was a collaborative event between the LBCA, the UCBA, and the Humboldt County Growers Association. So it was a really cool event. You know, we brought out all the dispensaries, and definitely check it out. And I'm looking forward to another one as soon as quarantine's over. But I may. So, Mezz is now being referred to in music. He is known all around for his amazing reefer, his bomb mota. He gets arrested in 1940. Once he's arrested, he is actually interrogated by a lieutenant from the narcotics squad.
he was interrogated to give up all of the other pot dealers in Harlem. He didn't snitch. In his book, he states that the lieutenant tried every way he could to make me stool on other guys who peddled reefer in Harlem. Mezz told the lieutenant, and I quote, "Prove to me that marijuana was a narcotic or did anything bad to people, and then maybe he'd talk to him." The lieutenant was so pissed that he actually got up in court and said to everyone that this man was responsible for introducing marijuana to Harlem years ago. In his book, Mezz said that his lawyer jumped out and bellowed. He said, quote, "You must be the most remarkable detective, and your narcotic squad must be top of the force. Here you've been on duty in Harlem for 12 years, knowing all about this fiend and monster, and never once were you able to so much as arrest him for these nefarious activities." Mezz states that in his sentencing on that day, he was actually sentenced to Rikers Island for 10 years. And on his paper, he was stamped DA, which stood for dope addict. I can only imagine how hard it is being incarcerated. Mezz didn't take it well either. He said in his book that he stared up and down and began to moan the blues to myself, just the way the colored boys used to chant their heartache and long time in the Pontiac Reform School. Suddenly, a name for those blues popped into my head, Gone Away Blues. In that moment, Mezz did something drastic. He grabbed one of the guards, Mr. Slattery, and he told him, "I'm colored, even if I don't look it. And I don't think I'd get along with the guys in the white blocks. And besides, there might be some friends of mine in Block 6, and they'd keep me out of trouble." Slattery jumped back, astounded. He studied Mezz, looked at him, noticed Mezz had a nappy head, and he said, "I guess we can find something." He also looked at Mezz and quotes, "Well, well, you're Mezzrow. I read about you in the paper so long ago, and I've wondered when you'd get out here." Slattery said, We need a good leader for our band, and I think you're the man for the job." Slattery slipped Mezzrow a little card. It said Block 6. In 1940, Mezzrow voluntarily avoided segregation. In that moment, to me, Mezz is an activist. Mezz is a civil rights activist. He's a cannabis activist. He's a musician. He is one of the staples in the Reefer Jazz era. After being moved to Block 6, Mezz actually joined the band. He was in the band and he led the band. And it's actually very significant. He talks about a story while he's in jail, his first concert. He said everyone was tense. He said everyone in the colored section was scared. They acted like their reputation was on the line. This was the Block 6 band. As soon as it went into full swing, everyone in the entire jail was in harmony. Music united all of them. And Mezz led it. Mezz is pretty dope. Haha, no pun intended. In 1942, Mezz appealed to the court, and the judge actually allowed him to cut his 10-year sentence to only 1 year. The judge said that this was because of how he treated and how he loved and how he cherished his mom when she came to visit him in jail. Obviously, I'm gonna say his lawyer, again, he got some of the best lawyers around, but 10 years to 1 year, Mezzrow. The reason Mezz is on High History is not just because he was a distributor of cannabis, but because he was an activist. He said that everyone he smoked cannabis with came to the same conclusion that cannabis wasn't habit forming. It couldn't be classified as a narcotic drug, especially since that there was no scientific proof being put up. He said that there was no laws against cannabis. You could roll it up just like you would go out and roll up a Camel cigarette. To us muggles, cannabis wasn't hazardous. He said it wasn't any hazardous than any of the great American vices. The 5-cent Coke, the ice cream cone, except cannabis gave you more kick for your money. Milton Mezz Mezzrow, the Muggles King, the Mighty Mezz but not too strong, is a cannabis activist, a civil rights activist, a musician, married a black woman, avoided segregation in prison, and is a pillar in the Reefer Jazz Era. And that is why you need to know about Milton Mezz Mezzrow. My name is Steven, and you can find me at the LBCA. You can feel free to email me at steven@thelbca.com. Have a good one, y'all.
Hi, I'm Eddie FN Diaz, and I have a joke for you today. If you're anything like me, smoking a joint is the happiest part of your day, until there's a roach on your finger. A joint walked into a bar. THC? Me and a friend got in the car. Hi. My mom walked in on me. Uh-oh. Hot box. The movie theater. Heart attacks don't come when you get high, just anxiety. One edible, two edible. Don't have a third edible. When you grind up your weed, do it safely.
Sorry.
And that's all you get for today. Thank you.
And welcome everyone to another episode of Behind the Leaf. My name is Steven Contreras. I am sitting here with a dear good friend and today's special guest, Robert, aka Robbie Cota, aka Loverboy 420. Robbie, how you doing today?
I'm doing good. Thank you, Steven. Thank you for hollering at me. You know, it's been a while. It's always good to interact with some friends.
Yeah, of course. So today I'm on a beautiful beach, if you can tell. And Robbie, what are you doing today a little bit?
Yeah, you must be in Long Beach then.
That's just where I am.
Today I just had only some of the, you know, personal errands, personal projects. Stopped here to talk to you. You know, I got a little joint rolled. Might spark that. That's all right.
No, please. I'll actually go. You know what? I'll set up a dab. But Robbie, tell everyone a little bit about yourself, because for me, you were the first quote-unquote young person that I met when I joined my cannabis activism, when I joined the LBCA, all of that stuff. So tell me a little bit about your history in cannabis and take me back to the day, because I know you've been doing this for a while. So let's tell everyone, how did all this start?
I'll take you way back, you know.
Way back.
I guess quick little history, quick brief about me. And I've been consuming and growing cannabis since I was 16. Mm-hmm. Over here in North Long Beach. Definitely not the ideal place to be growing, but you know, it was cool, it was fun. Family definitely didn't like that. My mother used to say all the time that you know, I'm gonna get in trouble or get end up in jail or hurt or something. I was studying, I graduated in sustainable landscape design and principles. So the study of drought tolerant plants and, you know, creating gardens, as hydroponic systems and so forth. So it was like, I did that because I was already into cannabis and yeah. I was hoping to transfer that knowledge over into my own grow operations. Mm-hmm. And at that time, I was maybe like 19. I ended up becoming one of two assistant horticultural specialists. I mean, I stayed with them from that point on, helping with the grow operations, first starting with the small stuff, helping with the clones in the front. It was actually the system was very similar to, you remember Wonder Brett's setup?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, that entire setup was almost exactly like that with the same.
So what was it like going from your personal grow and being like a connoisseur to going to a large scale operation?
Man, like Charlie in the Chocolate Factory, man. Like,
you're like that feeling.
Yeah, you're wondering where the magic happens and how it happens. You know, all you get to see when you're a consumer. When I first started smoking, you're buying flower and you're like, oh, this is frosty, this is purple, yeah. This smells great, you know. And you're like, you don't realize that that's leading you into something more. And going from a small little grow operation to seeing like everything on a large scale, the amount of power, water usage, the money put into it, the time, the manpower. I mean, everybody back in the day, when it came time to harvest, the entire like team, the entire sales force, the entire, all the workers, even the owners would be trimming. We'd had like 13 to 16 people trimming a couple hundred pounds of herb, you know, and the buds that we get in collectives are manicured. They're trimmed down to just solely the buds so that you can enjoy, you know, the flower that has the most trichome on it, the most properties that would actually benefit you. You know, it comes from the bud. Some of it you can still get from the flower, like the leaf itself, like the sugar leaf you would hear, you know?
Yeah.
You can still obviously, you know, make your own like tea and extraction and so forth. Everybody does that. But it's ultimately the flower that, you know, you want. And that's what you end up smoking. That's what ends up going in here.
You're at Chronic, 2010, what happens?
Oh man, so I believe the LBCA had just formed like early 2010, mm-hmm. where all the businesses realizes that they need to be represented, you know, to the city council, as well as we got a lot of local residents who are coming to they come to the dispensaries because they have questions of cannabis. So ultimately the dispensaries became the source of information. They became the source for everything that was related to cannabis. Mm-hmm. And that, I think that's what's really sparked them to get that started. And around that time they were doing maybe small rallies and so forth. But yeah, I guess flash forward a year or so, and around 2012, we had the Pac versus Long Beach case, and that really got everyone. The city ended up banning collectives and cultivation operations, anything that's cannabis related. Yeah, everything cannabis related in Long Beach. They were saying, look, whatever you know, the government goes with, that's what we're gonna go with. And everybody who had already started businesses and established themselves in Long Beach for the, you know, the past couple of years prior, was, you know, we've met so many people that not only need cannabis, but yet again, these businesses who were already in operation are just taking such a huge loss. And, you know, it was just kind of like, you know what, we know people need this, as well as, you know, as they became the source of information. So they started campaigning. I remember Long Beach Green Room becoming the number one headquarters for the LBCA. They had a call center. They had you could walk in at any time and like volunteer, whatever. You had an hour, you had 4 hours, you could come in and start giving people calls, or you can do the door to door.
Just to kind of recap, so August 12th, 2012, Pac versus Long Beach case ended up in cannabis getting pretty much banned throughout the city. And on August 12th, 2012, that is when all doors were shut down. And the very next day, like Robbie said, Long Beach Green Room became the hub. They became the hub to campaign for a ballot initiative. So Robbie, in 2012, was going to the Green Room to either make calls or to go knock on doors to get signatures for this people's-led voter initiative, which it was huge because this was trying to show city council and just represent everyone in the cannabis community that, hey, we want this here. We need this. We need safe access to cannabis. What was that like to see that? Because I don't know if you've ever seen anything like that before in your life.
I've never volunteered or advocated with a group of people. I never, like, there wasn't ever something that I can say I was so passionate about or driven about that I would want to go door to door and tell people about it, or try to get people to do signatures, or even show up at city council meetings. It's important for everybody to go out there and show face, show them that, you know, as a community member, this is important to you. We had so many smaller groups and organizations come to the LBCA that now they have so much support from different like facets of the city, from unionized workers to, you got the environmentalists helping with the beach cleanups and stuff like that. But shit, back in the day, I remember we did car washes at Chronic. We did car washes and signature rallies and stuff like that. Anything to get people to show support, because it was really hard. So many of the members of each of the collectives back in the day were so open and willing to hop on, hey, let's help campaigning. I'm pretty sure all of Chronic's and all of Long Beach Green Room's employees became volunteers immediately afterwards, because they, you know, this was all something that they were a part of and they believed in as well. So yeah, flash forward a little bit, we're in 2016 and we got Measure M Prop 64, and that's what really brought the dispensaries that we have back today back into, you know, what we're able to enjoy as the Long Beach cannabis community. You have some of the same leaders, the same original business owners of some of these dispensaries: Long Beach Green Room, Chronic Pain Relief Center, LB Collective, Care Collective, The Circle. Some of these have been around since day one, and they fought to get it open back up, and that's what happened in 2016. Then we had the MRSA, the Medicinal Adult Use Regulation Safety Act, 2017. In 2018, we finally got the adult use going. Mm-hmm. So, you know, from 2018 till now, 2020, like, that's also been a huge jump with the whole track and trace system and everything that's going on.
A lot more regulation came in.
Yeah, a lot of regulation, a lot of taxation.
Speaking of a lot of taxes, Robbie spoke when we went to city council the last year in 2019 to speak to lower the taxes across the supply chain. Before 2020, the taxes were 6% for pretty much everything. 6% for manufacturing, 6% for lab testing, and 6% for distro. And that was essentially just too much taxation, which was just not allowing for any successful business model. Robbie, I asked you to speak with me to city council. What was that like? What was taking that advocacy to the next step? Because you've knocked on doors, you've made phone calls, you've done the car washes, the beach cleanups. Now you're going in front of, 9 city council members. Well, at that time it was 8, so it was only 8. So 8 city council members, and they've seen you. But what was that like? What was that step?
Yeah, no, I appreciate you asking me to go up there and talk, because up until then, I've never, like, spoken on the city council. I've gotten chances to mingle and speak to some of them individually when we had events back in the day. But other than that, there hasn't been too much contact. It was good. I mean, one, being a member of the Long Beach cannabis community, as well as just being a resident of Long Beach, this has always been important to me. I've utilized cannabis for myself physically and mentally, you know, dealing with insomnia, physical pains, even just the sheer stress relief. You know, all this is one big machine that we're trying to get going, you know, and we want to make sure that it's positively impacts everybody. So I feel like just even being able to go up there and show any bit of support, like, that much more, like, it has to be done. So thank you for telling me, you know, hey, let's go up there and talk. And it's not easy, you know, and a lot of people, you know, they'll never hear about the side of it that gets all this done, because, you know, it looks so easy. You hear on the news, you see on the news, oh, cannabis is booming, they made this many millions, but you don't hear about how many millions they are in the red,
you know,
from getting to that point. And, you know, and you don't hear about the taxation that's been killing them and not allowing them to grow, you know, to reach that potential. I hate it because
people to the illicit market.
That's what I hate. That's what we don't want. I'm glad we were able to reduce the tax for distribution, so that way we can, you know, we can lower that and hopefully create a lower price point for everybody, so that way this is appealing for them. Yeah. It should be appealing for them to know that this is, you know, clean, safe product. But when the money's a factor, you know, that really changes people's, you know, mindset.
Yeah, how are we going to do things better? What does the future of cannabis look like? And I want to go back a little bit to when we, that big W on the city council, we won to lower taxes 8-0, undisputed. You can see that whole recap on our YouTube page, by the way.
LBCA.
And what was really cool is, so maybe about 3 weeks after myself and the president of the LBCA, we went and spoke at Costa Mesa City Council. Costa Mesa referred to Long Beach like 75% of the time when it was referring to actually lowering the taxes and seeing what Long Beach did. And it was cool because Costa Mesa did lower their taxes to 1%. On testing, they believe they lowered it to 0%. Which is even better, but
man, that should be priorities. I love it.
Exactly. And so it was really cool to see how people are looking at us, and we are pioneering the industry. And I believe that we are going to be, Long Beach is going to be the ideal city of how to roll out cannabis in any municipality. So with that in mind, what do you think the next steps are? Where do you see cannabis going? Where do you see the industry going? Or what's something that may not be touched on? And again, you're at a different level and this is your time. So where do you see the weak points? Where do you want change?
But for me personally, when it comes to like the future of cannabis, I'm obviously banking solutions off top. We need somewhere to be able to, you know, to get the money circulated, as well as to be able to, you know, put some of these companies on the map, get us, you know, on the stock market and stuff like that, get some real investment money. People don't realize how much money goes into this. Not only with the taxation and so forth, but just with the operational cost alone.
That would help a lot, especially right now, because cannabis businesses, they do need stimulus packages. And honestly, safe banking could be a huge aspect of that and can help. And I'm glad that that's in the talk right now. I know we haven't moved anywhere, but right now during this pandemic, I think there isn't a better time when we have proven we are for the people, we are for the community. Our entire industry is being proactive with this. So I'm right there with you, brother.
I think, as an industry that gets taxed so heavy, there should be, you know, the benefits of being able to have a bank, you know, like being able to, you know, to have resources. To be honest, we have so many employees and people. I've already heard of a couple of cannabis brands that had to damn near cut half their workforce because of this whole situation.
Yep.
Like it's affected everybody. But so hopefully we get the banking solution figured out soon. That's one of my top things. Another thing for me would be actual cannabis users in office. And like for me, I've talked to a lot of individuals, and I've been to a lot of meetings. We went to that one that the BCC held, and a lot of the individuals there who are in charge of regulating our industry, and you know, and pushing this forward, don't consume cannabis and don't even understand like the actual cannabis culture itself.
Yeah.
So I would like to see more users, whether it be, I'm not saying like just smokers, you know.
There's
tinctures.
There's everything.
There's so many things. So I would just like to see a lot more cannabis consumers actually on the forefront on that end. As well as being more eco conscious, more socially responsible. I love seeing the brands that get involved with like the beach cleanups at the LBCA host. I love seeing the inner city work that you guys have been doing. Some of the most fun, like the Christmas one, they gathered so much food, so many toys from all our partnered dispensaries that, you know, participate.
Hundreds of pounds of food, bro.
Yeah, no, that's that. I think that's that for me is what I want to see more of in the future of cannabis. Yeah. And that's always been where the heart of it's been at.
I do want to kind of touch on something. I know me and you, this is kind of another area where we connect on, but sustainability in the cannabis space. Right now, there is no sustainability. There is no recycling program set in place.
Create a department for to look into is the environmental impact of everything that we're doing. Yep. I love growing. I love cannabis, but with such high power usage, water usage, the amount of nutrients and runoff, like what is that going to do to our environment? Especially being in a beach city, we all know it goes towards the beach.
Yep.
Anybody who knows Cherry Beach knows it's a disaster. Should we be able to do some kind of recycling program? Should the BCC or the other entities create something where if we have to dispose 1,000 carts because they, you know, passed the due date or something, can we empty them so that way the parts of the cartridge can go back to manufacturer, can be properly recycled and yep. reduce the waste factor.
Mm-hmm.
It might be an extra step or two, but I think in the long run, we'll be happy that we did this.
Yeah, I agree.
That's my mindset when it comes to the future of cannabis.
Hey, you're right there with me, and I don't see anything wrong with that. I do think that there is a lot of steps that need to be taken. I mean, if we look at the whole industry right now, and I'm not going to point any fingers, but I know that only 3% of the entire industry is practicing sustainability. I do believe that that is going to be part of the future, but I acknowledge that we have to get proper regulation. We have to get everything dialed in before we can even take those next step. But I'm glad that there are a lot of like-minded people that are already socially aware of that and environmentally aware that all of this stuff. And it's even better seeing it people who work in the supply chain, people who work in the industry who want to change it. Because I know people on the outside, they don't even see it yet. So Robbie, please tell everyone where they can find you, where they can find Wally Drops or anything like that.
First off, stop by the LBCA for more information, as well as you can find me at loverboy_LB420. The LB is for Long Beach, everyone. And man, nothing more can be said other than thank you for, you know, what you guys do. I appreciate being a part of it and look forward to you guys including me in any of your guys' efforts. I do what I can to advocate, so thank you guys.
Well, thank you for being an advocate. Thank you for being part of our community. Thank you for being part of our media team as well. We appreciate you, Robbie. I am glad that we are all together fighting this fight, the green fight. For me, you can find me at the LBCA. If you want to get in contact with me, it is steven@thelbca.com. But thank you, everyone. And I will see you next time on another episode of Behind the Leaf. Thank you, Robbie.
Take it easy, man.
I'm Warren Blasovsky. I'm the founder of LB Atlantis and Vaporwave Cannabis. I grew up and went to high school in Long Beach. That's where I met my partner, Ryan Elmore. We were in real estate together for a long time and have both always loved cannabis and took this opportunity to start a cannabis business so that we could share cannabis medicine with people statewide. I was originally a pharmaceutical scientist in San Diego, and when I graduated from grad school, UC San Diego had opened a medical marijuana research facility. For me, it seemed like that was career suicide at the time, so I put that interest aside. I ended up getting into real estate, which resulted in me being a real estate broker. And then when the new cannabis laws came out, it provided an opportunity for me. I'm a very low risk individual, and so although I supported medical marijuana, I wasn't able to get into the business myself. When everything changed, I know it created a lot of challenges for the existing industry, but it also created opportunity for someone like myself that had both a science, pharmaceutical, and real estate background to put a new company together. I've been a regular cannabis user for over 20 years. I find it helps me with things like chronic low back pain, anxiety, and insomnia. I've also been following recent medical developments that cannabis also has anti-cancer properties. I have a dear friend who suddenly found out that she had brain cancer when she got into a moped accident. And so she had a lot of side effects from the surgery as well as the anti-seizure medicine. And really, cannabis is one of the only things that can treat this inoperable type of brain tumor. I think the cannabis business is going to be a long play business. A lot of people jumped in between Canadian hedge funds, Wall Street types, and bankers. And they jumped in to try to get rich quick. And what we're seeing now is that a lot of them are getting out of the market and companies are losing billions of dollars. This plant has been with humanity for tens of thousands of years. And we need to honor that education and that medical history that comes with traditional knowledge and also combine that with good modern business values to create a sustainable company. And that's what we're doing at LB Atlantis. Licensing is a very kind of important and rudimentary part of the business. Being that I had a real estate development background, we really did focus on license development because license development really is the foundation of any cannabis business. We do type 6 manufacturing. That's the state license type. And we're also licensed by the city of Long Beach as both an adult use and medical manufacturer. The type 6 license allows us to do all types of cannabis manufacturing like extraction, distillation, infusions, and packaging. We use those licenses to make products like vaporizer cartridges, different types of concentrates with our custom terpene blends, and we've also come out with a new product. It's a THCA crystal. It's over 99% pure THCA. We package those in a couple different brands. Our primary brand is called Vaporwave Cannabis. You might have heard of us. We have a popular event in Long Beach called Terp Thursdays, where industry people get together and talk about the business and share stories and generally have a sense of community. And then we're also developing new product lines. One of them is our Dial It In Dispensary line. Dial It In Dispensary is going to be a customized cannabis medicine in a box. So just like you would go on Blue Apron or Stitch Fix and pick out what foods or clothes you want to wear, you'll tell us via an app or the telephone what type of symptoms you're having. Let's say you have insomnia and knee pain. We will create a custom box, deliver it to your door so that you can find something, cannabis medicine, to help you sleep at night, but also something to use for pain in the morning that doesn't make you drowsy or groggy while you're at work. Another brand that we're coming out with is called Anointed Oils. It's a healing brand that focuses on topicals and using ancient healing techniques like Ayurveda and other herbal medicines as well. We have another brand coming out called THC Active. This is gonna focus on the exercise community, especially with THCA, which is a non-psychoactive version of THC. This can be especially effective for pain and recovery that comes with heavy exercise. LB Atlantis also specializes in helping other brands come to market. We've been especially focusing on dispensary clients. Because retailers are not able to create their own products, we can come and fulfill that need for them. And what we find is that when a retailer has their own brands, it gives them more clout and more visibility in the community. Some of the biggest brands in the state are known for the different strains that they grow, also their personalities and their lifestyle brands. But for smaller retailers, newer retailers, it's hard for them to get into that space due to the state licensing requirements. What we can do is come meet with a retailer and design a house brand around what their customers' needs are. This helps both them with visibility, marketing, as well as often cuts out a few layers of middleman marketing to increase the profitability for those retailers which are struggling right now. Something that we love doing is building cannabis facilities. Our first facility, 2,500 square foot, opened in West Long Beach in March of 2019. And we're currently building three new facilities also in West Long Beach near the corner of Santa Fe and PCH. We call this our Santa Fe project, and it consists of four different suites with four different licenses in those suites. The first will be an edibles kitchen. This is a type N infusion license specifically devoted to the production of edibles. In fact, we've gone as far as to put in two large dehumidifiers that take 250 pints of water out of the air each day because of what we've learned about challenges, for example, in chocolate manufacturing. That facility will be online in April of 2020. The next facility in that building is an 1,800 square foot distribution hub. This will allow us to distribute not only our own brands, but other companies' brands. The third suite at our Santa Fe facility is a 3,000 square foot cryoethanol extraction facility. This will allow us to create large volumes of distillate for further downstream processing for our pharmaceutical factory and also to sell to other customers on the market. And finally, the fourth unit of the Santa Fe facility will actually be a cultivation processing license. Something that we've discovered in the market is an inefficiency between cultivation and processing. The way that the state law is written, only cultivators are allowed to process whole plant and separate out the A buds or flower, the B buds or smaller flowers, as well as the trim and stalks. So this will be a processing facility so that we can help cultivators process their large volumes of material. That's not all we're doing though. We're opening a third facility. It's in the city of Montebello, and this is going to be a pharmaceutical factory, regional distribution, as well as the retail delivery. I talked to you a little bit earlier about Dial It In Dispensary. That retail delivery dispensary will come out of that East LA Montebello facility. as well as a recreational delivery service called Discreet Street. Those will both be launched later this year. And finally, that facility will have a 6,000 square foot pharmaceutical type factory. This should be the first pharmaceutical cannabis factory on the West Coast. And we are bringing in our team of medical doctors and pharmacology doctors to create the Dilaudin dispensary pharmaceutical line that comes in a sealed package, and it has your personalized cannabis medicines delivered to your house each month. You asked about hurdles, and I will share some stories of hurdles in the cannabis business. There used to be a saying from a famous marketer named Dan Kennedy that all businesses are the same, except that weird real estate business of flipping houses is a little bit different. Well, after a couple years in the cannabis industry, I would add that cannabis is in fact a different beast as well. Cannabis comes with different challenges than I've experienced in other businesses. A couple things. One, like we talked about earlier, is just the many thousands of years of history of the cannabis plant as a medicine. And if we get too far away from that legacy and the importance of that plant, possibly in the development of civilization, then we can lose some of the core value of why we're here. So the first challenge in cannabis is balancing our core values with running a profitable business. And another challenge has been constantly changing regulation. So when we started this business, the state had not issued regulations yet. And what we found was that the city was not willing to let us move forward with our project while the state had not issued regulations. In summer of 2018, the state issued their emergency regulations, and all of a sudden the city was able to start approving building projects. So that initial 6 month of paying mortgages and paying rent was difficult for every business. But I still think that we feel lucky here in Long Beach because we were able to get through the process. And if we look to neighboring larger cities like Los Angeles, there's people that are 3 years later still paying rent. So I think just the slowness and the newness has been a challenge. Also, Reefer Madness is still alive. And it's not as overt as it was a few years ago, but when you deal with the cities, you find out that there's different factions within a city. And so you might have a building official that wants to help you move your project through, but maybe the city manager's office or the mayor's office or one of the city councilor's office is not so supportive. And so it's a level of municipal dynamics that I've never experienced before. The one thing I will say that Long Beach has going for it is because the voter passed initiative, MM, Long Beach City decided to adopt a ministerial process for cannabis licenses. And what that means is that if you have a property in the cannabis zone, you by right are allowed to develop a medical cannabis business. That's different than a lot of cities where you've got a competitive process. And in our experience, a competitive process often is a corrupt process. And so I will say that Long Beach does have less of those problems with having to do heavy lobbying or outcompete other groups, because what we find is when there's competition between licenses, it's really the one with the most money, the most lobbyists that's closest to City Hall that ends up getting a license. So I would say that amongst all those challenges, Long Beach does seem like a more fair playing field. I think qualifications for working in the cannabis industry, especially in manufacturing, I'd say the number one qualification is really a passion for cannabis. People that have devoted their life to cannabis, that are called lifers, they're gonna be in the cannabis business for life, they seem to make the most effective employees. At the beginning, we thought that anybody with a college degree possibly would make a good employee, and what we found is really the passion and believing in cannabis as medicine is important for successful. Other than that, I mean, what's important in an employee, it cuts both ways. So having a passion for cannabis, but also being able to function in a normal business setting. And so what we do is we do work closely with the Long Beach Employment Opportunity Office. to look for equity candidates. It's a requirement of our license, and we also like equity candidates. So we often attend, or we've attended all their job fairs. We do a lot of our hiring process with the cooperation and assistance of the Long Beach Employment Opportunity Office. You can find Vaporwave products at Chronic Pain Relief Center, Connected Bellflower, Connected Second Street in Belmont Shore, also at the station, the Long Beach Green Room, Connected Cherry, Connected Santa Ana, and LA Kush. We're adding new locations all the time, so check out our Instagram at Vaporwave Cannabis for up-to-date listings of our in-store activations, specials, and events.
Hello, this is Pam from the LBCA. I apologize for the wet hair. I'll explain why I am kind of a mess right now in a little bit.
Hi, my name's Ishka. I am a volunteer and member of the LBCA media team, and I am really excited to share what my 420 was like with you.
Hi guys, I'm Gabby. I'm also a volunteer for the LBCA and part of the media team, and I'm hoping you guys had a happy 420.
Eddie, how you doing?
Hey, what's up everybody? This is Eddie FN Diaz. I'm in my garage. I'm here to help out, do whatever I can with the LBCA. Yeah, I'm excited.
Cujo, welcome to a conversation fueled by my Rove pen. It's glue, if you're asking. If you have any experience, you know what I'm experiencing. But Cujo, the LBCA, and I'll talk some 420.
Robbie, how you doing?
What's up, y'all? Happy post 420. It's your boy Robbie, part of the media team, volunteer. Hey, let's talk about it.
Let's talk about it, and that's exactly what we're about to do. So we are in quarantine for the first time ever in history, and we had supposedly going to be the 420s of all the 420s. It was going to be 420 in April of 2020. It was all month, and it was supposed to be amazing. And we spent it indoors. We spent it social distancing, but I think it was super historic because we all had virtual sessions, virtual parties, virtual activities. And it was really cool to see how social media and technology played and still brought this sense of community together, even though we couldn't, you know, actually share and have community together when consuming cannabis. So Pam, you work at a few of the shops over in Long Beach. What was the 420 like for the environment and just what you experienced?
It was actually, I feel like it was busier than last year because it was like steady busy all day till like about 7-ish, 7, 7:30.
Yeah.
But it was like super busy and people were coming out. You know what I kind of thought too? Mm-hmm. I kind of had a feeling like the people that were there that we talked with at the shops, the customers that came in, I had a feeling a lot of people, not maybe a lot, but maybe some of them were from the illicit market. They usually shop at the illicit market, but were coming out for deals at the legal market, if that makes sense.
That's actually really cool. That's super dope.
I don't know if that's true, but I feel like it. It was almost the same rush, I feel like, that came after the first health order of the pandemic. It was kind of like that.
Yeah.
And people were still at home celebrating, though. Like, you know, people were happy, and they were appreciative of, like, we had some decorations and a little bit of festivities, not much. Like, some raffles and deals, of course, but they were happy for that, which was cool. Because we want that. That's what we would be doing.
What the LBCA did for the first time is we also had a 420 dispensary live tour. I actually started off right at Chronic, and the first thing I noticed is, like you said, the rush was still there. There was people wrapped all the way around the parking lot, 6 feet apart, but it was still
six feet apart.
Yeah, it was unique to just see that it really didn't stop anyone. And like you said, people were coming out for the deals, but there were also those people who just came to pick up and, you know, just get the percentage off that each dispensary was offering. Ishka, I joined you at Haven.
Haven was great. All of the stores are really beautiful, really clean. You know, one thing that's always impressed me with everyone from Haven, whether in their store or out just representing their stores, is their customer service and just how compassionate they are. And so they've got a lot of really great team, and you see that, you feel that throughout, you know, all three locations that I was able to visit. So, and I love downtown Long Beach and the local art that they were exhibiting. That was awesome. Like, you know, go check it out even just for that. It was really great.
You also had a few virtual sessions. How was that?
Yeah, so my 420 actually started the day before with LA Normal. I was able to co-host with Rico Lobby a sesh with a lot of different people. It was a 50th anniversary of Normal celebration and a relaunch of LA Normal. So that was really exciting. That was on a different platform though. That was on a platform called Big Marker that was not as easy to use. So then the next day on 420, my Cannabis Babes had a glam sesh, our first group sesh, and that was on Zoom, and that went much smoother. So it was a lot of fun and had a lot of people turn out.
Gabby, how was your time visiting the station?
That was my first time there, and I actually didn't know that information when you said that on the live, that used to be a jail.
Yeah,
I didn't know
an
that.
Actual police station.
No police station, okay.
Yeah.
So my 420 was pretty busy. I was working a lot, actually, so I went live on my Instagram. I recorded a vlog. I had my own work. And then I also decided to get some footage of different dispensaries and the lines that they had, because I noticed that there was a lot of people, a lot of lines, a lot of different dispensaries. I had to drive to work in LA, and there was a dispensary there with the line all the way around the block. So it was crazy. I think that this was the busiest 420 I've ever seen, but that's just from what I've seen.
Cujo, how are you doing? How was your 420?
It was good. I knew it was going to be an interesting one, just given social distancing, and I think on a daily basis people are getting kind of fear sold to them, not solutions. So everybody is kind of a little standoffish, but I did turn up with Rob at, what was the first dispensary we hit, Rob? I kind of stayed out because I'm a big person and I didn't want to kind of crowd people in that atmosphere. But we turned it into an opportunity to kind of cut up a little documentary, which I'll drop this weekend for y'all. I think aside from that, the glue is settling in. Is anybody smoking anything heavy, or are you guys all in the sativas?
I'm smoking some chili beans.
I'm smoking something heavy. This is a cookies and cream from
Kind of Survive.
I'm still on that grease monkey.
I'm diving live sugar 3 TK.
Smoke responsibly, Robert. Robert, how did you see that day? How did you enjoy it?
You see me, man. It's big smoke. You actually tried this. This is what we smoked.
That's the Samoa?
That one, no.
The Samoa?
I already blew through the Samoas. That was my 420 smoke. I saved all the top shelf stuff for 420.
Yeah.
This is the after, the post smoke, the slightly cheaper stuff. But it was a good 420. Like you said, I could tell people were a little standoffish. Definitely everybody was a little frustrated with having to be, you know, 6 feet apart. There was a long wait. Most of the time you're waiting outside of the dispensary as opposed to, you know, what the waiting room was for. But ultimately when you got in there, most of the people kind of already knew what they wanted. I think everybody was really good on social media with promoting their deals, not only for the shop itself, but the brands that were highlighted for 420. Care Collective had a bunch of green balloons everywhere when you walked in. Good vibe, good music, real jovial kind of feel. So a lot of people are leaving out there real happy. Definitely, you know, it's definitely a different light when you're stuck at home and everything's going bad, and you come in here and you kind of got this little mini of a celebration. Definitely, you know, brings some good vibes to your day.
How do you think this 420 is going to be remembered? What do you think the legacy of 420 2020 is going to be?
Yeah, I feel like this 420 is going to be just remembered as a reflection of what cannabis use is to you. People are really thinking about what's essential to them, So they're coming in here with a different mindset than before.
Yeah.
So I that's what I think is going to be remembered as. People, you know, just a year of reflection, I think.
Yeah, the year indoors, you know, and maybe the first of many. I still don't know about that. But definitely the year indoors, you know. I mean, for me, it's momentous. It's definitely given my business a different kind of a push. So I'm not mad at it.
I totally see that. I see, like, it's just like a, I feel like because we're in cannabis or in, like, the community of cannabis and we're so used to pivoting, and adapting and changing.
Yeah.
For the last, like, couple years, especially.
That's one thing I can say I'm definitely impressed about.
You're just up for it.
Yeah.
Or at least gave us, like, some armor.
I feel like that's just what I do.
I feel like it just gave us some, like, armor for this. Like, I feel like, okay, well, it's just more changes rapidly, but we're kind of used to it.
Speaking of that, Pam, I'm, like, super impressed how quickly everybody picked up their own procedures before it even kind of being a thing that was city-wise acknowledged, you know, with the whole distancing and just everybody sanitizing as well as, like, the extra protection. I've seen, like, the little on the counters now they have, like, dividers, you know, like almost like a bank teller. So, like, that it was, you're right, it's cool to just see the industry kind of, like, already used to having to, like, oh, something happened, we gotta, you know, pivot this way, and they adapted so quickly to the situation
seamlessly almost.
Yeah, it really felt like overnight. I came in one day and I was like, oh, okay, like,
yeah,
it's a new procedure.
Yeah, yeah, like the dividers, our dividers are on the way. We ordered those, like, not that long ago.
Yeah, it's really cool. Coming. It's really cool to see.
I don't even think it's a bad thing. I think they could possibly even keep them up. Like, it's only going to make it cleaner and healthier for everyone.
Definitely.
To the point where we have to adapt to this new normal. We knew that wasn't, like, we realize we're not clean. Like, at the end of the day, the world's really dirty, and so now we're adapting. But I think it's also going to benefit all of the patients, the medical patients, the people who go in who have cancer and need a place to actually be clean, who already have a weak immune system. Like, it's something that I think benefits our industry right now.
I agree.
So now that we lived through a quarantine 420, what do you think future 420 events are going to be like when we actually have the event licenses? Do you think culture has shifted? Is everyone going to be sharing joints? Is everyone going to still be cleaning? Is after every dab, is everyone going to have an alcohol swab?
I'm hoping that all this having to be sanitized, having to be sanitary, and just us thinking about, you know, more of what the actual people who are there for the events, you know, how we can make things wheelchair accessible, things easier for veterans and so forth. I think this is really going to change the mindset of the events. We have a lot of, like, seshes and a lot of gatherings that just are kind of, like, thrown together real, but not by anybody professional, like, not a planning party or anything. It's just kind of by the whim. I'm hoping that by having this licensing process and with all this situation that everybody actually rethinks and puts a lot of good attention to detail it's providing for the people that are coming to these events, because if a lot of them are, like you said, you know, they might have a weak immune system beforehand, and we have to provide a place for them that's already clean, as well as, you know, can provide other things for them.
Yeah. Yeah. I totally agree, because people are, I mean, as many times as we try to, like, look at spaces to do events and try to do things at, I would always be the person that would say, it's not ADA compliant.
we need a certain,
like, we would check off every box, and we would just be like, okay, we can't do it here.
But we adapt.
We find somewhere else.
I think a lot of people are going to be doing things a lot better in the future with these new procedures that they're going to be adopting.
Mm-hmm. We knew we needed a higher standard even before this, though. You know, like, there's a lot of different events that don't help break the stigma.
Cujo, what do you wish for the future of cannabis? What do you wish for future events? Like, now future.
Mm-hmm. I think it was Ishka who said, like, let's do a tour. I'm totally on board with that. I think that we can kind of work together with some different networks and get to know the dispensaries up and down and you know, just keep expanding. Who knows about us and vice versa. That's what I see as the future, is getting to know people, because cannabis people are good at what they do, like Eddie.
Man, I really don't know. I've been to a couple of the high time events and stuff like that, and I hope we can go back to that, but I mean, dabbing, everyone's gonna be distant for a while, but at some point we're all gonna go back, just because it's true, like, it is a sharing thing. You're gonna light one up and you're gonna share it with somebody.
Do we pass drinks like that?
I mean, I think some people do, like, they'll say, hey, taste this beer, or hey, taste this, you know what I mean? Same thing with joints, like, hey, taste this, but it's not necessarily like the entire time or passing it all the time, but I think it is a sharing thing. And I mean, too, if you have a friend who comes over, you guys want to dab, you know, I don't know. I think that we're going to probably adapt, just like Pam said, we're just going to adapt to it. But as far as how it's going to go, I don't know.
I think we'll always have events, because right now, like, my husband made a good point, and he's just, because he always thinks like an 18-year-old. Just kidding. But kind of. But like, he was like, he's like, can you imagine how many secret, like, underground parties are happening right now? He's like, the best parties are happening right now that you have no idea about, because you're just not in that circle. Or like in that kids, that circle. I'm like, yeah. He's like, what would you be doing like right now if you were like, you know, that age, 20? I'm like, oh my God, I'd be going to every freaking secret party. And I don't know. You just wouldn't comply.
Okay.
It's because they were like more of in a rebellious stage at that time. And like, I feel like that stuff's going down right now. Could be. I feel like it's like almost like having, like, you know, little speakeasies going around everywhere. I think those are definitely happening. They're just not being on social media, because like, people are probably like checking their phones. Like, people are probably definitely being safe that way, so they don't get, you know, but I think they're happening. I think they are. So I don't think it's going to change. So I think once like things are released and you can start doing events, it'll happen. We're going to have to be social. People need to be social. And like, doing this, even though this is what we can do right now, it's not going to be enough for us humans. We need
social
interaction. You know, we need social interaction. Even if it's 6 feet apart, like, they still need.
I mean, I'm personally excited for like stuff like the beach cleanups, or, you know, anything where anything that's eco-conscious or anything that's socially responsible, like, that's more of like, I'm just can't wait to get back to that. I know right now people are even more hesitant to come out to these type of things, and I want them to
you
know, be able to come back to what we used to do.
But hey, you can still do that stuff now. So the reason why, like, I have just like jumped out of the shower and immediately came on here like this is because right before this, I was part of this volunteer system where I just delivered to a 300 apartment senior housing.
Nice.
300 meals. And you can still volunteer, like, if you're willing to go and like put yourself out there. But honestly, like, I came home immediately and like jumped in the shower, because, like, you know, like a closed environment for a couple hours. And even though you're not touching much and you have gloves and everything, it's still like a lot. Like, I figured that, I mean, that's what like the front lines do. Like, you come home and you immediately just like strip and you take a shower. Because like, you're like, you're fomite by this time. Like, you are like attracting things on you. It is. It's like a whole thing, because it's like now, like,
the contaminated. Whole family knows.
Now you're contaminated. Now, like, you are contaminated. So that's what I feel like after. But like, doing the volunteering is really cool. You could just, you know, people can just, you guys can just hit up me or Steven, and we could put you in touch with this. So it's happening every day, and they do, I forget how many meals they deliver a day, but it's lunch, around lunchtime, between 11 and 3. And there's two restaurants that are making food every day. It's Lola's and The Ordinary, actually. And so they make food for all the senior buildings, and they just have, and then the UPS goes and picks up the food. They like package it and everything. And then they deliver it to the senior buildings, and the volunteers go to the senior buildings and then deliver. So then it puts those restaurants back into, you know, they get paid from this nonprofit organization, like $10 a meal. So they make all this food, and then it gets delivered through UPS. And then volunteers like us, we could go to those places and help just disperse it. That's seniors awesome. Are funny. Let me tell you, working with seniors again, it's fun.
That's dope of you, Pam. That's sick.
Yeah, it was fun. So I do it twice. So I'm doing it twice a week until whenever this is over. So I'm doing it Thursdays and Sundays. So if you guys are interested,
I'll be there.
Well, I mean, if you guys want to pick up a day or
this Sunday,
like today, it was only three of us, and then like I don't know, two thirds of the way through, there was only two of us. It was a lot. It was a lot, but it was fun. It was good.
Yeah, I appreciate you letting us know. I'll let you know soon. I'm trying to still do some of my garden volunteering, but I need to hear back this week on that.
Yeah.
And it's about 2 hours, I would say. Oh, and we have the biggest building, so there's smaller buildings it takes less. So like at the most, it would be 2 hours.
Eddie, how was it going out during quarantine and filming our little segment for High History?
That was crazy. That was really interesting because nobody was on the street. I mean, you had some hobos and just some randos and a couple other content creators,
pretty much a bunch of hobos.
I mean, man, I don't want to get into it, but it really is a crazy time. I saw a little accident happen. Some guy broke his leg.
Oh my God.
Off a bike, which, I mean, it just shows that everyone's a little bit it's a time.
Oh, he literally just flipped over. Like, he wasn't riding his bike, he wasn't walking his bike, he just turned and his ankle snapped
bad.
And me and Eddie were there. We ended up staying with him. We called 911 until a paramedic showed.
Oh my goodness.
And then me and Eddie, we went right back and started running around.
Because we got to bring this content.
I could see why you said that you couldn't capture that energy again.
Break
a leg energy.
And then we had people
break a leg in energy. Yes.
Right. I would just want to remind everyone, please volunteer. Hit up Pam or myself, and we'll be more than happy to give you information. We will probably be here Sunday, but this is going to air after. But still, reach out. We're more than happy to give you any information. We are accepting donations. We are making COVID-19 bags with masks, hand sanitizer, just for the essential workers. So please feel free to reach out anytime. And thank you so much for tuning in to At the Root of It. Have a good one, y'all.